more cycle track that goes from Bodmin in Cornwall all the way up to Bristol, and it takes you through some glorious countryside. This bit here is particularly special. I almost stop here because this seems like a perfect spot for otters. And in fact, there are otters here. There's probably one watching us right now. But even though I've stopped here literally dozens of times, I've never seen one.
I'm not that surprised. Although otters are one of our largest carnivores, they're incredibly secretive and hard to see. 40 years ago, otters very nearly became extinct in England. Yet, they seem to be making a remarkable recovery.
But what do we really know about them? Where are they? How can I see one?
In the next hour, Springwatch's confirmed otterholics, Charlie Hamilton-James and Simon King, will delve into the secret life of the otter. And Chris Packham will explore just what an otter's made of.
And I'll be delving into the otter's past, looking forward into its future, and trying, with the help of some simple detective work, to see how you and I can actually see one for ourselves. So, welcome to the Springwatch Guide to Otters.
One of our most charismatic animals. It's inquisitive, playful, elegant. But the otter has another side. It's a skilled hunter, fiercely territorial about guarding its patch. And what a patch. Otters live in some of the most gorgeous places in the British Isles. They recolonized these islands after the last ice age, and over 10,000 years they've spread out from Indian rivers in the south, right up the coast to the northernmost islands of Scotland. They're generally solitary, secretive creatures that like to keep themselves to themselves. You might just glimpse a swirl here or a whiskery snout there before it vanishes into the water, leaving nothing but a trail of bubbles. So, what kind of animal is the otter? It's time to meet the family. Chris.
Well, the otter is a member of the mustelid family of mammals. There are 54 species across the world, but we have 7 in the UK, and here they are. You'll certainly be familiar with some of them. What about this little chap down here? This is the weasel. They're ferocious little carnivores armed with really sharp canine teeth. And this one is especially designed to dive down into mouse and vole holes where they predate those species. Its slightly larger relative, the stoat, does a very similar thing, except that it is after rabbits. Over here, we have the polecat. Now, these are very closely related to the domestic ferrets that people keep. And then, the most arboreal of all of the British mustelids, the fabulous and exquisite pine marten. Once a species you could find all over the UK, but these days, sadly restricted to Scotland, although they are spreading out. Perhaps the most familiar of all of them, though, is this animal, the badger. And here you can see that typical of this group of animals, it has 5 non-retractable claws on its front foot because it's using those to dig its set. That just leaves us with the two semi-aquatic species, the mink and the otter. Now, the mink here is not a native of the UK. It was introduced from North America. In fact, it's made a bit of a pest of itself. But the otter is truly a native. And when it comes to identification, well, look, the mink is significantly smaller. So I think that if you get a good view of an animal swimming through the water, you shouldn't mistake anything in the UK for the fabulous otter.
And most of us, when we think about otters, you probably imagine them in a river. But they don't just live in rivers, they also live by the coast. Some people think that the otters that live in salt water and the otters that live in fresh water are two completely different species, but they're not. They're the same species, the Eurasian otter. And of all the 13 different species of otter that live in the world, the Eurasian otter has the widest distribution. And if I had a map, I could show you. Blow me down. Good Lord, I do have a map. So look, you can see in the pink, that's where the Eurasian otter is distributed. So the otters are here. Here's the heartland in Europe. They go down south to Morocco and all the way across here, across the Himalayas, down to Indonesia in the south, and now up here to Kamchatka Peninsula in the north. But for our otters, although they're all the same species, they do have two very different lifestyles. On rivers in the south, otters are almost entirely active at night, while the coastal otters of the north, who rely on the shifting tides to hunt, are out and about by day. One of the best places to see otters in the UK are the Shetland Islands, off the north coast of Scotland. Here, the sea has battered the coastline over millions of years to create 3,000 kilometres of perfect otter habitat. A rocky coastline full of shallow pools with plenty of sea caves to rest up in. So this is the ideal place for Simon King to give us his first guide to otter watching. So, Simon, when you're out trying to spot otters, what's the first thing you look for? Seagulls, obviously.
Yes, a black-back, great black-back and herring gulls, all scavenging birds looking for an easy meal. If you see any of those three species sitting on a rock, looking down into the rocks, it means it's watching an otter that's already feeding. And then you can very carefully move yourself around to get a view of the otter.
Following them really closely is all down to field craft.
If I'm to stand a chance of a very close view, I've got to make my way down the beach, and the only way I can do that is to move when the otter is underwater. On the surface. And down, okay. Otter dives. They only last much longer than 30 seconds, so I don't want to move. He's up. I'm going to move for much longer than 20 seconds. And down again. Okay. I'm just going to tuck myself into the rocks. So it's absolutely vital that the wind is blowing the otter towards me and ensures that my scent doesn't reach the otter. Okay, it's got a big fish. It's coming towards me.
To see an otter, like Simon, you've got to try and think like one.
Whilst he was in Shetland, Simon got to know a couple of otter families, each living either side of a bay. There was Em, a lure cub on one side, and Flo, with two cubs, on the other.
Beautiful views. This is Flo off to the right. That's the adult female. There's two cubs to the left, 18 months old now. Pretty independent, those cubs, but they still depend on their mum for a certain amount of food and, of course, an enormous amount of care and affection. They're very, very close family unit otters. Look at that lovely serpentine grace moving from land to sea as one, and otters that swim together, dive together. Look at this, one, two, three, all of them down, looking for food, we thought, but then within about a minute or two, the cubs were up on the surface, having a complete barney. Now this isn't a scrap, this is just hijinks, having a good time. But nothing being done with any serious aggression here. This is the sort of behaviour you might see when otters are courting, but right now this is just the youngsters playing together. And then this one loses his leg. Where's he gone? Where are you? Okay, there you are. I thought the game was over and then it's all up. They're just superb to watch. Absolutely magnificent. Where's he gone? Oh, there you go. Quick bundle. And then no sooner did they disappear than one of them came up with a huge fish, a lump sucker. They went back into feeding. And the game was over.
Twice a day, these otter families have food delivered right to their door. The rising tide fills the shoreline with a seafood smorgasbord. Although their main diet is fish, in Scotland, otters are very partial to crabs. But whatever they're hunting, otters are spectacularly maneuverable underwater. How can an animal, originally designed for life on the land, be so good in water? Over to you, Chris.
Got to watch your fingers, but this is a fabulous place to appreciate just how well the otter is adapted to its aquatic environment. I'm at the British Wildlife Centre in Surrey, and these are obviously tame otters. They use their rear limbs, which are well webbed, to push that body through the water, and then they have that strong, stout tail which they use as a rudder. The entire body is incredibly supple. It can twist and turn and bend. And when they're swimming as fast as they can, they undulate that body to improve their stroke, as it were. They want to be as streamlined as they possibly can. And as you can see, they've achieved that with a long, lithe, slim body. Honestly, beautiful. You know, when I was a kid, I was obsessed with otters. I was so obsessed that my mother made a fake fur otter. It was a terrible representation of this beautiful animal, but I would wind it up at the foot of the bed and then shine a torch on it and squint to make it look real. If this had happened to me when I was 8, I'd have burst. I'd have burst spontaneously.
Ah, oh, a childhood dream fulfilled. But come on, Chris, focus. Back to the engineering.
To really understand how an animal works physically, we need to look inside it, and we've got a fabulous opportunity to do that here with this articulated otter skeleton. If we consider the vertebral column here, it's got all of these flanges, and those are muscle attachment points. Now, the bigger and broader they are, the larger the muscle is that's attached to them. So I can tell you, for instance, that there was a lot of muscle tissue there, and therefore this is a very supple and sinuous animal. And let's look at the feet, because on land, this animal is walking on the soles of its feet, just like we do. And that tells me that it's not fast moving, because typically, animals which are fast moving run on their toes. Think of cats and dogs and horses, of course. Of course, here it doesn't need to be fast moving on land. What it wants is ruled feet, which are webbed, as you know, because these are used for pushing the animal through the water. So what we've got here is an animal that's supremely adapted for an aquatic lifestyle.
There's no better way to see this than when, on a calm day in Shetland, Simon found an otter swimming in gin clear water.
It's really unusual to find a steep drop-off like this with water directly beneath that's shallow enough to attract an otter to feed. And it's one thing to watch these animals on the surface, but look! I have to say, this really is the clearest view I have ever had of an otter hunting like this. And it's immediately clear that it's not chasing fish directly, or not at first, but instead, there you go, charging after fish that it disturbs from under rocks and through the seaweed. It spends most of its time foraging through that weed in the dense bladder wrack and kelp. Little bit of a breather. Again, you never get to see their feet when they're on the water surface like this, but you can just see she's so at home, perfectly relaxed. What a great view.
Now, Simon King is clearly a confirmed otterholic. But there's one other cameraman who's always trying to get even closer than Simon. That is my good friend, Charlie Hamilton James.
I saw my first otter when I was 16 and I've gone to Shetland just to see otters.
Luckily I've had a lot of cups of tea, so better keep myself warm. I think it's too cold down there.
The otters won't hang around long, so I need to get on with the serious business of being one of the only people ever to have swum with a truly wild otter. Usually they're incredibly wary, the slightest smell of a human and they're gone. But in the water, my scent is hidden, and whilst they know I'm here, they don't know what I am. I can see an otter working the shore, and I'm swimming gently towards it. And then suddenly, it appears. My first shot of an otter in the water. It's incredible how close I'm getting, and although inquisitive, it's still carrying on hunting and fishing. As it swims through the water, I can see for the first time how otters use their whole bodies to propel themselves along, not just their tails and feet. It's quite simply breathtaking to watch, and I feel it can't get any better, but it does. This bold and brazen dog is swimming up to investigate, but coming so close he touches my camera. It really is a once-in-a-lifetime experience.
That is, without a doubt, the best wildlife encounter I have ever had in my life, by a mile. It's unbelievable.
Now, like Charlie and Simon, I've spent some time in Shetland. And it's not always sunny and serene.
Self-respecting mother otter is getting pretty cut out in that.
It takes a lot stop an otter. This mother and her cub are out fishing, even in gale force winds. They have to eat every day. If they don't, they'll starve. And surviving in these chilly North Sea waters requires some high performance equipment.
The otter's fur is short, fine, dense and velvety, and it's also extremely good at doing two essential things, keeping it dry and keeping it warm. Let's take a closer look at the fur using this microscope. Just focus it. You can see that the coarse hairs there are what we call the guard hairs. They're about 20 millimeters long, and they're covered with a water-repellent oil, and it's these that keep the otter dry. But if I part them and we delve underneath into the under fur, these hairs are shorter, between 10 and 15 millimeters, and they occur at an incredible density. 60,000 hairs per square centimeter all over this otter's body. And they're really good at keeping it warm because they trap a layer of air here at a temperature 10 degrees higher than the surrounding air or water. And when it comes to staying warm in water, you've got to try hard, because we lose temperature 27 times quicker through water than we do through air. Now, if you've got a coat like that, you certainly need to look after it. And one thing you'll notice is otters spend a lot of time grooming, particularly if they've been into salt water, because the salt leads to the breakdown of that oil, which is keeping the animal dry. So they'll come onto land, actively look for fresh water to bathe in, and then spend a lot of time grooming, often in traditional spots. At the end of the day, if you've got a coat like this, you want to keep it in tip-top condition so you're nice and dry and warm.
I could do with a bit of extra underfur myself. It's bitter. Now, we've seen otters frolicking about in broad daylight on the coast. I don't know about you, but when I think about where an otter lives, I tend to think about something like this. A river. Fresh water.
In southern Britain, otters live not just on rivers, but in lakes and marshes too. Anywhere, in fact, where there's water and plenty of bushes for cover.
Here, it's much harder to follow their lives, because on a river, otters come out at night.
There's no twice daily tide bringing food, but with dusk, the river comes alive. Away from prying eyes, fish like bullheads and eels emerge. And under the cover of darkness, otters come out to hunt them. As the otters emerge, so does Charlie, hoping to share their lives. He's spent more time than anyone filming their movements at night. Tonight, he's using a thermal imaging camera, which works by detecting heat and shows up any warm-blooded creature on the river.
Got the ducks on it. So come and go in the river, and the ducks are right up against the edge. That's really hard to see. Come on, there's the otter. Got the otter right near the ducks. Can't see it. I can just see the ducks. There's the ducks.
It's very special about seeing an otter at night like this. And I guess it's because you're seeing something that you shouldn't really be seeing. from all the hours he spent watching them at night, Jolly's noticed the otters are constantly alert. They're hypersensitive to everything that's going on around them. The family cruise the river like a well-oiled hunting machine, diving after fish, rooting around rocks to dislodge crabs and crayfish. Now and again, they rest up in special places, their holts, hidden behind bushes or perhaps beneath a tangle of tree roots. And this pattern of resting and hunting, is how they pass the night. But I wonder if you, like me, have ever wondered how on earth otters find food in this murky, pitch-black water.
One of the ways the otter is going to be finding its food is by using its whiskers. These highly modified hairs we call vibrissae, and they are extraordinarily sensitive. Well, not the hair itself, that's dead, but it's the tissue into which it's rooted that is absolutely packed full of neurons, nervous tissue, and this transmits the information to the animal's brain. And in otters, that part of the brain is significantly larger than other species that are not so reliant on their whiskers. But you know, it's not that the whiskers actually have to touch their prey or anything they're looking for, because they are sufficiently sensitive to be able to detect the vortices. Now that's the churned up water that fish have left behind them when they're swimming through the river. And what's even more astonishing is that these animals can actually detect which species of fish has been swimming there, even when the fish is long gone. That's remarkable.
That's an astonishing bit of biology. But when it comes to hunting, it seems that otters may have an even cleverer trick up their sleeve. Now, after hours and hours of patient observation, Charlie Hamilton James thinks he's discovered something completely unexpected. So Charlie, I'm imagining I'm an otter. Yep. I'm swimming around at night in possibly murky water. That's a tall order. Now, apart from using sensing movement of fish, what other senses could I use to hunt?
I've got this theory that otters also use smell and water.
Yeah, but they're mammals like us, so we have to go shh, and they're holding their breath. So how on earth can an otter smell underwater?
Well, otters, they're supposed to have their nostrils completely closed underwater. But I used to feed the otter in my garden because I was rehabilitating one to release it. And I used to put her fish in the river so that the rats didn't get it. And she could find it. Wherever I put it, she could always find it. So I was always thinking, well, how can she find it? It's not moving.
It's not moving at all.
No, so the whiskers thing, that's not doing anything. Right. And it's dark and the river's all murky, so she can't see it. So there's got to be something else going on. So I thought, well, I better try and film it. I invented some kit with an underwater camera, and I also put a nappy in it because it leaked. And then I put it in the river, and I put a couple of infrared lights on it to light it up, so it's still pitch dark. I tied a dead fish to a brick, I stuck it in the murky river at night, and it found it straight away.
How? Can we see it?
Yeah, have a look.
Here's the dead fish.
There's, yeah, and it's very quick. The otter comes in, picks it up, it's gone.
Now, how does that tell us that it's smelling the fish?
Right, well first, I didn't know anything else was going on other than it had found it. So I had to go back and look at this thing, and try and work out what was going on. And this is what I noticed. If you play it back really slowly, there. There's a little bubble.
I thought that was just its nostril, but just that little flash there.
A little flash. It's putting a bubble out, and it's sniffing that bubble back in. And that's going to get loaded with
with scent, you know, the chemicals of the fish. And then once it's worked out what it is, pick it up and swim off.
It actually exudes a bubble of air that somehow captures the scent and it sucks it back into its nose.
Absolutely.
Did you just come up with it? Is that just the Charlie theory from nowhere?
No, it's not. I knew something was going on because I knew they could find them. And then I'd seen a BBC documentary, and in it they featured star-nosed moles, which are these very cool critters that hunt underwater. And what they'd done is they basically filmed them in very slow motion and proved that they are smelling by putting out bubbles and sniffing them back in again.
The scent is in the water?
Yeah. But I put cameras above the water. I wanted to look down on to see exactly what was happening. So not just underwater. And you can see she comes up the river and she goes past the fish, yes, and then she suddenly makes a very sharp turn and grabs it.
So she's
spotted it.
She's detected.
And a bit like the wind, she's, you know, the river's going in one direction.
Yeah.
So any scent's coming down the river. And then when she went past it, she obviously clocked it and came back around and grabbed it.
So whatever it is, she clearly can do it. She is picking up that scent.
Yeah.
And it looks like she's using the Charlie bubble scenting theory.
I think that's probably what they'll call it from now on.
Science and action, folks. Now we know otters are supreme swimmers. They have a highly sophisticated sense of both touch and smell, all of which combines to make them very, very good at catching fish. And that skill would inevitably bring them into conflict with humans. For hundreds of years, in Britain, otters have been hunted.
Organised hunting of otters was going on way back in the 12th century, partially to control their numbers. But by the 20th century, otters were being hunted purely for sport. Someone who used to hunt them was James Williams, now one of the foremost otter experts in the country.
What was the structure of the hunt?
Well, I mean, got a picture here of my father, who was the master of the hunt, and there he is with some of the officials and the hounds, and
great,
he organised where the hunt would go, and then they would meet at 10 o'clock or 10:30 at a bridge or a house, and set off to try and find an otter and see if they could have a hunt.
I've got to say, you've got the most wonderful collection of dogs in this, haven't you? They're
purebred otter hounds.
Oh, are they? These, yes, are purebred otter hounds?
Yes, purebred otter hounds, oh, yes, and more. You can see there what fine, upstanding animals they are. They're wonderful, wonderful hounds, and I love them.
And everyone's on foot?
Yes.
Am I right? It's all, yes, there's no horses or anything
no
like
horses,
that.
It's all on foot.
All, yes, on foot.
Yes. And long poles, which people sometimes say they were spears, they weren't. They're just walking sticks because you've got to cross the river.
Now, with a fox hunt, the fox will be in a bush or a... But an otter's going to be a much harder quarry, I think, to find in the first place.
Because there are far fewer of them, the first thing you have to do is to find where the actual otter has gone in the night and to follow its scent, which we call the drag, and hope that eventually you would locate the otter.
How many separate otter hunts would there have been up and down the country?
About 24. The most places were in the territory of an otter hunt.
What sort of effect did the hunting back in those days have on otter numbers overall?
Very little effect. We know that otter hunting was going in the reign of King John, and otters survived perfectly well. I think the hunts were fairly beneficial in that they stopped people tramping, because it was much more fun to see if you could have a hunt and a day with your friends than to set a trap and go in the morning and find a mangled corpse. Right. So I think the hunt, in fact, had a slightly protective effect.
But for all that, between the 1950s and the 1970s, there was a sudden and dramatic decline in otters. The hunts were the first to notice there was a problem, and they immediately sounded the alarm. But the numbers of otters continued to fall, and in 1978, otter hunting was made illegal. Something was devastating the population. and finally, after lengthy investigation, the cause was discovered. Toxic chemicals, introduced in the 1950s, were being used by farmers to kill pests and prevent fungal infestations. The poisons were washing into waterways and building up through the food chain. Otters are a top predator in our rivers, so the toxins accumulated in their bodies to dangerous levels, causing blindness and fertility problems. By the early 1980s, otter numbers had crashed by up to 90% in England. They were on the brink of extinction. But a fictional tale about the life of an otter in North Devon, written at the peak of the hunting period, had begun to change people's attitudes. It was Henry Williamson's Tarka the Otter.
Oh, this is Tarka when a child. The eldest and biggest of the litter was a dog cub, and when he drew his first breath, he was less than 5 inches long from his nose to where his wee tail joined his backbone. That's a bit twee, isn't it? His fur was soft and grey as the buds of the willow before they opened Easter tide. That's all right. He was called Tarka, which was a name given to otters
many years ago by men dwelling in hut circles on a moor. It means little wanderer, or wandering as water. Now, I read Tarka as a child, and it's a mixture of poetry and raw, almost brutal reality. And Williamson was a realist. He even joined his local otter hunt to make sure that the book was as accurate as it possibly could be. But when he wrote Tarka the Otter, 85 years ago, otters were still plentiful. The great crash in their numbers hadn't actually started. So this isn't really a book about otter conservation, but it did start to change the way that we think about otters. And that change continued with the publication of this book, Ring of Bright Water by Gavin Maxwell in 1960. And this book and the film of the book cemented a change that was already happening, turning the otter from vermin into a treasured part of our British wildlife. Otters had had a makeover. Now they were playful and friendly, and there was an outpouring of support for them. Otter conservation hit the political agenda, and they finally became legally protected in England and Wales in 1978, and just a few years later in Scotland.
Ready? Wrong bit, where are
you? Come on. Meanwhile, new conservation groups had sprung up. And one of these was the Otter Trust, set up in 1972 by Philip and Jean Ware. They were so passionate about otters, they bought a farm in Suffolk and created large breeding enclosures by a lake. Rescued otters were taken in and bred in captivity. And in 1983, the first three otters, two females and a male, were released into a river in Suffolk, where it was hoped they'd start a wild population.
So the otters took a massive hit. But then the chemical pollutants were banned. The otters got legal protection, and a lucky few even got a helping hand directly. We had paved the way for their recovery. Now it was up to them.
Good news for the otter's recovery is that it can breed at any time of the year and produce a litter of two or occasionally three cubs. The den might be an old rabbit burrow or a hole in a tangle of tree roots. It just needs to be snug and secluded. The cubs grow quite fast, playing and sparring with each other to build up their strength. It's not until they're about 4 months old that they first venture, tentatively, out into the water. The family call to each other with piercing whistles to stick close together in the dark. teach them how to hunt underwater. And over the next 8 months, they'll learn all the skills they need to become fully independent. So if you ever see a group of otters together like this, it's invariably a mother and her cubs. The male dog otter doesn't stick around. Whether on a river or by the coast, dog otters are loners. As soon as they're fully grown, they move away from home to find territories of their own. And this, they guard aggressively against anyone. One of the ways they define their territory is by marking its boundaries with scent. Otter sprint, their poo, is a language all of its own. Left on rocks or sandy mounds, it's a warning to keep out, a message that Simon has clearly failed to heed.
And here it is, on all of the little high points, this rock, great mass of sprint, here, behind me here, and if you get a close look and there are still the odd bubble on, then just keep still, because the chances are the otter's only just been here and it's somewhere nearby.
Sprint is actually a complex method of communication, and just how complex has only recently become clear.
Oh yeah, look at that. You can clearly see the reflective qualities there of a lot of fish scales. And of course, to the otters, this material has another very clear function, and it's all about communicating through smell. And I've got some fresher samples that have been collected here that haven't dried out. I'm going to give them a bit of a sniff test. Now, some people say that it smells like freshly mown hay, some jasmine tea, but to me, that's just pure otter. The smell is made up of 100 different components, but 17 of those are used by the otters to identify the sprint to an individual level. So if an otter was to sniff this itself, it could tell you whether that was male or female, 5, 6, 7, 8 years old, whether it was sexually mature, whether it was sexually active. It's Brian, and he's had a fish masala without any doubt. Now we can take DNA from this sprint and identify the otters down to individual level. So you see, far from being a nuisance and something a bit quirky, otter sprint is incredibly useful both to man and beast.
Over the past few decades, signs such as sprint and paw prints have been used to try to chart the otter's comeback in England. And although overall this shows encouraging signs of recovery, it's difficult to know exactly how many otters there are now in the UK. Trying to identify individual otters using their tracks and their sprint, it's notoriously difficult. But in the future, this new DNA technique should make it much, much easier and help us build up a more reliable picture of overall otter numbers. Research so far suggests otters are steadily recovering, with numbers estimated at somewhere around 2,000 in England and perhaps 8,000 in Scotland and Wales. In Scotland, where hunting's now been banned for 30 years, Simon recently found signs that otters are getting bolder.
This is an otter trap, or as they're known locally, an otter hoose, built to trap otters for their fur. This would have been the area that the otter was attracted to going in, and here there would have been a wooden sliding trap door connected to a string that went inside the structure to a pressure pad, and if the otter walked inside, touched the rock, the door would close behind it. And then when the otter hunter came by on his rounds, he'd lift one of the big rooks to the top, kill the otter, take it out. Now, of course, otters are fully protected. What is so fantastic and ironic is that this otter trap, at least, is being used very, very regularly by the local otter, or otters, as a resting place, and their sign is everywhere. There's a sprank here which is no more than an hour old, and I can see where the animal has collected bedding and made a lovely, warm, cosy nest just inside. How strange that a structure designed to kill otters should prove to be a des res.
As they slowly spread across the UK, otters are finding new friends to help them on their way. On a rain-soaked day last year, I went to help some volunteers led by inventor Chris Matcher making specially constructed otter holts. I put up plenty of bird boxes, but an otter prefab? Making a flat pack, well, you know how it goes.
D?
D, where's D?
Get your round here, guys.
Yes, it should be the other way round, shouldn't it?
That should be that way round.
B, that's B.
But seriously, when you're not filming, this hole can be put together in under an hour.
That's it.
Girls with power drills. Very exciting. Chris, thank you for a marvellous day out. Look what we've created.
Thank you very much.
I shall volunteer for more of this sort of work. Let's get out of this!
Excellent. And helping otters isn't just about building nest boxes. Sometimes it means playing surrogate mum. When these three orphan cubs were found by a roadside, a local wildlife sanctuary took them in. The cubs had never been in water, so when the time was right, a swimming lesson was arranged. Over the next 18 months, the cubs were taught to hunt and fend for themselves, and eventually, they were put back into the river very close to where they were found. The one thing that has helped the otters' recovery more than anything else is the clean-up of our rivers. And although pollution is still a problem, many rivers have improved dramatically.
Otters are a litmus, a test for the health of a river. And their presence shows that now, many of our rivers are the healthiest they've been for 20 years.
That's good news, not only for otters, but for all our river life. It's not just our cameras catching glimpses of otters. Here are some of your photos from around the country, courtesy of our Flickr photo group. No longer restricted to coast and countryside, some 21st century otters are living right amongst us. In the cathedral city of Winchester, CCTV captured these remarkable images. A mother and no fewer than three cubs playing quite happily directly underneath the city's mill. The Wildlife Trust now estimate that otters are established in at least 13 urban centres. In Manchester, evidence of otter activity was recorded for the first time since the early 1900s. And in Newcastle, Simon was thrilled by the sight of an otter in the heart of the city.
That's the trail of bubbles that every otter watcher wants to see. I find it truly wonderful to think that as we drive over these bridges in city centres, scenes like these might well be playing out under our wheels all over the country.
and this is testament to an enormous turnaround in the way we treat our waterways. The fact that otters and herons can find sufficient food in these urban rivers and pools is a clear sign that these fresh waters live up to their name. Just that, fresh and life-giving.
Now, otters are naturally long-distance travellers, and that's what's bringing them into our cities. But not everyone is quite so pleased to see them in the suburbs. Some garden ponds have been receiving some very unwelcome visitors.
Imagine a small pond with a big, sluggish koi carp in it. To an opportunist like an otter, it's irresistible.
It's not just ornamental fish ponds that are getting hit. Up and down the country, otters are becoming a real headache for commercial fisheries too. And I'm off to Somerset to try and find out exactly what's going on.
This lake is owned by an angling club in Bridgewater, and today its vice president, Danny Denahay, is having to restock it with carp.
Now Danny, I can't help noticing the whole of the lake is like cold hits. You've had to go to some really extreme lengths to protect this.
Yes.
What has happened?
Over the last 4 years, we've put in approximately 4,000 fish. Last Thursday, we had about 50. Mainly roach, small bream. The 1,500 carp we put in, more or less gone.
That must have been crushingly disappointing for you.
Terribly. Terribly. Yeah. It's costing us an awful lot of money. The fence, we've put the fence up to try and stop what we believe is the otter doing it.
There are a variety of different animals it might be, not just otters. Mink will go for roach and bream, and with a slump in fish stocks out at sea, more and more cormorants are coming inland to hunt.
What's led you to think that it is the otter, in general?
Fishermen are actually seeing them on the big lake over there.
Yeah.
We've also found paw prints, spats, dead fish.
Dead fish, yeah.
Dead fish.
From the photos of fish carcasses taken by the club, it does look like otter. They'll go for carp because they're slow and easy to catch, and they typically pick out the muscle just behind the gills, leaving the rest of the fish untouched.
We believe that they're coming from the river, which is in that direction, okay? And we believe that they're using that as a superhighway to come off onto lakes like ours.
And they're opportunistically looking for feeding places, and they find your fishery.
And our fishery, and help themselves.
As otters are legally protected, Danny's had to invest in putting up some sort of barrier to keep them out.
And you had to sink that into the ground, I guess?
That's gone into the ground, about 18 inches into the ground.
It's not a cheap option.
No, very, very expensive. For a lot of people, it could be the difference of being in business or going out of business,
yeah.
You know? And stock is the most important thing.
That's tricky. And the growth in commercial fisheries and fish farms happened when there were hardly any otters around. And now the otters are making a comeback. Well, for an otter, this must be like finding a free all-you-can-eat buffet. I suppose the only option is to think very seriously about fencing.
All these sightings of otters could give the impression that their comeback is complete. But in fact, whilst it looks like they've recovered their range, they definitely haven't recovered their numbers. But they are coming back. And that means we've all got a better chance of seeing one for ourselves. So, how do we go about it? Well, I know just the man.
Okay, Charlie, I've got maybe 10 minutes. I am desperate to see an otter. How do I see one?
You're probably not going to see one.
Oh, no.
To be honest. But there's a whole selection of signs that you can look for to tell you if there is an otter there, at least.
So we have to turn otter detective.
I know the basics of what we're after. Paw prints. Holts in the banks. And the heady smell of jasmine tea from the sprint. But I'm hoping Charlie can fool me in with some fieldcraft tips. I've got the right man, and he's scaring me to death with gruesome tales of their leftovers.
If an otter eats a trail, yes, it'll hold it like that on the body, start with the head. Till it's gone. You'll find the crayfish will be the head and the claws they'll leave. If you find the back of a crab, often they'll have a single hole in it. You know, the canine of the otter has gone through it. Rat tails, so they've eaten the whole of the rest of the rat and they've just left the tail.
Okay, Charlie, enough. Show me some hard evidence now.
What's the very first thing in your top 10 otter signs? What are we looking
this,
for?
This, basically, look.
All these little dotted things.
There you go. All the way. Straight away. Any nice wet bit of mud along the edge of a river, if it's got otters, it's generally going to have footprints.
I mean, that could be a dog to the untutored eye. What are we looking for that makes it otter?
Well, key thing is it's got 5 toes, an otter. And dogs and foxes have got 4. But they're so distinctive. Look, you can see these teardrop paw marks, like upside down teardrops. And straight away, they're sharp at the end like that.
What sort of size?
Look at that!
I always have a little measurer.
You're looking at about 5 centimetres. I would have said that sub-adult, teenager maybe.
Early teens. Also.
Yeah, you know that it'll have mum with it. So if there's a mum and a cub, that somewhere on this river will be a dog otter, because you'll have a huge territory encompassing several different females. So you know, from seeing these small prints, there's probably 3 otters here.
Amazing.
You know, we're only seeing the prints of one.
Now, Charlie, this is interesting. It looks like a sort of a trail here, going over there. Could that be otter?
Absolutely. Otters cut corners all the time.
Right.
And they cut corners when they're going upriver. They don't need to cut corners when they're going downriver, because they've got the energy of the river. So they're not expending any energy. But when they're coming upriver, it's much easier to get out and cut a corner off. Now, obviously, otters are fishing a lot of the time. But sometimes they're not. It is on a mission. Right. And you're trying to film them, you're trying to keep up with them, and they're just on it for 2 or 3 miles some. Where is he going? Are you late for the cinema? The fishmonger shutting? I don't really get it. But this is when they're cutting corners.
Otter's on a mission. He knows what he's on about. Ugh. Okay.
Paws a bit deep there, Martin. Oops. Let's go tiptoes. That is the classic otter hole.
That is an otter hole.
Yeah, it's a hole in the root system of an ash tree, which the otters love to dig up into.
So where's the entrance? The entrance is that bit there where it's sort of a bit muddy.
Yeah, you can just see the hole in there. There's not just one here either. Mm. So there's another one 200 metres down there.
Right.
Under a hazel tree. And all the way up the river, every few hundred metres, there's another one. That's a classic rock. The otter's going to come out and go out and pull on there. Oh, look at that. Hey!
Ooh!
Isn't it lovely?
Look at that!
Now, most otter scientists and enthusiasts, they like to pick it up and move it around in their hands.
Yeah.
Not me. I use a stick.
Are you listening, Chris Packer?
Okay, so you can see they've been eating crayfish here. The big bits of shell, and that's why it's red.
Well, now here's the crayfish, but this is very different, Charlie. It's green for a start.
It's very fresh, and it's green. They've been eating fish here.
I can see little fish bones inside there. Yeah.
This is, it's almost still wet, so you're talking in the last 48 hours. And interesting, sometimes you find these, they've got bits of moorhen in them. You love moorhen.
This is a signalling system, so they're going to drop a little bit here and a little bit further up, a little bit further up.
Yeah, I mean, they don't sit there for 15 minutes reading National Geographic, I think.
Are there any final tips?
Well, if you want to see an otter...
I do.
You've got to get the wind direction right. So what you want is you want the wind coming off the otter and blowing into your face. And if you do that, you've got a pretty good chance of seeing one.
Brilliant.
There we are, the Springwatch Guide to Otters. We've learned what an otter is, where it lives, what it gets up to on our coasts and rivers, even in our cities. We know its history, and most importantly, how to go about seeing one. But there is one last question.
Did I, during the making of this film, get to see an otter for myself? Yes! Charlie! I just saw an otter. I just saw an otter swimming straight towards something. Just literally in this pool here. It's coming straight towards us.
Did it see it?
Yes, because it was only there, feet away from us. First time in my whole life. Within 2 minutes.
Well, I've only seen about 5 otters here in the daytime in my whole life, living.
It was an otter in that pool, not 20 feet away from where we are right now. I never dreamt I would see a river otter for myself. And we'd only been there about 2 minutes. It just shows it can happen. But I promise you one thing. If you ever get to see a wild otter for yourself, you'll remember it for the rest of your life.